Jay Leno's here. Welcome to West Virginia. You'd said you'd been here a few times before.
Well, I've kind of been everywhere before, but yeah, I've been doing this a long time. And, you know, John Denver was a good friend of mine, and we were pretty close, and he would always sing, you know, West Virginia, the great song. So it kind of reminded me of that. In fact, that's what I was thinking about when I landed. He's been gone for, God, must be close to 20 years now.
Yeah, you know, been a while.
I didn't start my career with him, but in the 80s, we worked together, Tahoe and Vegas, and just a real nice man, you know. Just nobody's really doing that kind of music anymore, so it's kind of sad.
That's very true. On to happier note.
There you go. Hey, I brought it down. I pretty much brought that interview a screaming halt.
You've been doing stand-up since you were 19. I've read 300 nights a year.
Well, not through about 210 nights a year.
Well, splitting hairs here. All right, but when do you sleep?
Well, I sleep when I'm only working an hour and a half a night, really.
Well, that's so a valid point.
Yeah, it's not really. This is not not in a coal mine, you know. So it's not hard work. It's just, you know,
having fun.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Exactly. I don't complain.
Travel? Does that get old?
No, it's okay. I mean, that's what the job is, you know. So it's fine. It gets, and you know, funny things happen on the road. When you live in California, you live in Hollywood. The funny things don't happen because, like we're doing the Tonight Show, there's always somebody there there's an applause sign, so you don't really know if a joke is funny.
Oh.
You know, and just all these sort of things. So you need to go on the road and find out if the stuff actually works, you know?
Sure. Being on the road and observational humor and seeing what's going on many times, is this your own creation? Do you have people that offer you jokes or try to explain funny things to you and you incorporate them?
Well, a lot of times people say funny things and don't realize that it's funny. That it's odd. You know, you go like, sure. Oh, that's kind of interesting. I could do something with that. I had something happen. I was up in Canada and I was in Hamilton, which is about 60 miles outside of Toronto. A little town. It's one of those things where I'm staying at the hotel. The hotel's on a highway. I didn't have a car. And there's like a little strip mall with a dollar store and a cafeteria. So I go over to the cafeteria, I'm getting something to eat, and I see this guy. He goes, "Hey, you that TV fellow? Are you the fellow from the TV?" I said, "Yeah, I'm Jay. How are you?" "Oh, yeah, how you doing there?" You know, I could see he wants to ask me something, you know. He goes, "Hey, can I ask you a show business question?" I said, "Sure." He said, "You know when you see those shampoo commercials, you know, where the gals are in the shower and they're doing their hair and everything?" He says, "Do they have any clothes on when they do this commercial?" You know, so I said, "No, legally they have to be naked because it's a shower and you can't say you're taking a shower unless." And he goes, "Oh, well, I didn't know that. Are the fellas holding lights and things?" He goes, "Oh yeah," and I guess he's getting all worked up about this, you know. And it just—I mean, in an era, I live in Los Angeles where there's pornography on Christmas Day if you want it. This little guy in Canada—he's fantasizing about this Prel commercial, and it just made me laugh because he said, "Oh yeah, and what did he say? How did they audition them?" Then I had him go, and I said, "Well, a friend of mine—that's his job—to audition girls." He goes, "Well, the gals come in, they take showers," and you go, "Oh man. Well, how do you get a job like that?" And I can see he was going to go home and just go through all this. And you know, so those kind of things, those don't happen when you stay home. You don't get those kind of odd
Hopefully
things like that.
Home.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly.
Very good. West Virginia, a nice place here. We've just fixed it up, put a fresh coat of paint
on it. It's a beautiful place. I know it burned down in 39.
Correct.
And I guess they're really in no hurry to get it back up. I mean, it's been
a few years.
Yeah. I mean, if you were supposed to go on that night in 39 when the fire happened, chances are you're not doing a makeup date.
No.
But it looks great and it's fun. And you know, it's a classic theater. You know, a lot of guys like to do HBO specials and all this kind of stuff. I mean, I like to come to where the people are and do it. Some people like to stay home and just get the check. To me, it's more fun to go to the place. Because the stories change, and you can add and subtract, and you try different things, you know. So it's just fun. It's what I enjoy.
Yeah, we're looking forward to it tonight.
Well, thanks.
Right. I'm done. This is cool. We can sit here and talk.
Yeah.
Get a beer or something. But you know. Anyway, how did you get interested in cars? Just grew up around.
Well, I grew up in an area. excuse me. I grew up in New England, which geographically, well, it's not. It's sort of similar, small town. Mm-hmm. Everybody had a broken lawnmower, broken tractors, certainly. We had 3 acres. There were always vehicles that were just abandoned in a field. And in those days, I remember somebody abandoned an old Renault 4CV, a little four-cylinder French car. And we were 12, and we got it running. And you know, my mom would walk through the kitchen window. She's doing dishes, and we went in a circle in the backyard. Of course, now they call child services, and the parents are taken away, and you know, and the kids are put in a foster home because they were driving a car. But back then, it was just sort of, boys were expected to sort of know mechanical things, and it was just something that you did. You always fixed a broken snowblower or a lawnmower or something. You know, I remember taking engines apart and taking the head off and going, well, here's a problem, Dad. There's a piece of paper in here between the head and the cylinder. It must have got clogged in there. I didn't know it was a gasket. Before I said, well, put it back together. I put it instead of... I go, okay, oh, see. Then he goes, that was the gasket. That wasn't a piece of paper. Okay, so you just sort of learn like that.
Kind of learned as you go.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. But the Jay Leno's garage, like I said, I love it. It's more of a museum than a garage.
Well, I mean, we have fun. I get tired of the kind of car shows where guys with tattoos stand like this and restore a car in a week, and it's not really possible. I mean, we try to find the human element in it. Every show has a theme, you know, the car my father drove, and you find people who have, like Paul Allen, who just passed away. Now, he is obviously, what, 60-something billion dollars. Mm-hmm. And he came to the garage, and his dream car, which he has, is a 73 Buick Electra, because his dad had one. And his dad would take him to school or whatever, and he would drive around that Buick Electra, you know? And you realize, here's a guy could have
anything.
All the Ferraris and Rolls Royces, but, you know, he wanted that because that's what his dad
and
had.
He's driving a Buick.
Yeah, and that's what's fun, when you make that human connection with the car.
Oh, you're a Buick guy.
I am a Buick guy.
Your favorite car is
I still have my
55
Buick. 55. I bought in 1972, only two payments left.
All right,
and,
good.
And, I still have it. And my wife dated in the car. We got married in the car. Drove it to my first Tonight Show, drove it to my last Tonight Show. So it's fun. It has a lot of meaning, yeah.
I'll bet. Anybody else?
Perfect.
He has a show to do.
I'm all right.